See you guys. Awesome. Well, let's start in a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you for today. Thank you that we can come together as a body of believers and just encourage one another and wait on you together. Lord, I thank you for your Psalms that just give your character and show of your love and show of even our sinful nature and of who we are and who we are in relationship to you, God. But I thank you specifically for Psalm 25 that affirms that those who wait on the Lord shall not be put to shame. And I thank you for Psalm 73 that says, Lord, we want to be near you. God, would you make yourself near to us? Would we make you our sovereign Lord and our shelter? And so we pray for this time that we would just rejoice in who you are and give all praise, all glory and honor to you and you alone. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. You never change. You never fail, oh God. True are your promises. True are your promises. You never fail, oh God. How I
God, thank you that you were, you are, and you will always be faithful, king, in control, sovereign, and so much more, God. Thank you that every good and perfect thing comes from you.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, now many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. Oh, it's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. close my eyes to see my King in majesty. Your grace compelled my soul to love and draw in close. I lift my hands and I sing, surrender everything. In you I know I'm found. My God, to you I bow, now until forever. Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know more of you. I'm desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you.
Through the fire.
Through the fire, I'll persevere. I won't submit to any fear. Where you go, I've been before.
Where you go, I've been before. Right?
My trust is in you, Lord. Now until forever. Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know more of you. I'm desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you.
Now until
forever. Jesus, I surrender. Show me what I don't know more of you. I'm desperate for your presence, longing to be with you. Lead me to a new place, more of you. Lead me to you.
Open my eyes.
Open my eyes. Let me see more of your love. More of your love. just for a glimpse of you, God. I'll wait for you, God. Oh, open my eyes. Let me see more of your love. More of your love. Oh, here I will wait. Just for a glimpse of you, God. I'll wait for you, God. Just for a glimpse of you, God, I'll wait for you, God.
Lord God, I thank you for this time to just call out in your name, Lord. Your love is like no other. It's so tangible. It's so alive, God. You are alive. And I thank you so much that in any season that we're in any depth, in every valley that we might find ourselves, God, you are right there with us and you walk with us, God. And we want to see you, Lord. We want to see your face, God. Thank you because of Jesus, Lord. The veil is torn and we can behold your glory, God. There is no shame before you. There is no condemnation. There is no horror. There's nothing to be afraid of, God, because you are so pure and holy, God. And we worship such an amazing, high, and beautiful King. So, Lord, we thank you for this time. We praise you and we ask that your spirit would just fall in this place, God, and breathe through your word into our hearts, God, that we would just continue to leave this place running towards you, running towards people who don't know you, and just tell of your goodness, God, that we would just be faithful servants unto you, so that we can see you in heaven as a reward. So we love you so much for this time, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Nothing like good worship, right? Well, hey guys, welcome to the multi-purpose room. This is a much more intimate setting for us. It's good to see you guys. Definitely, as she was praying, so we see you guys faithful. We see you guys faithfully here. I know some of you guys are coming a little distance. You guys are making a drive to come out here, and that's awesome. It's one thing to sit at home and be comfortable and just watch it on the screen. But it's a whole nother thing to be here in the house of God, you know, and actually being able to, like, see each other eye to eye and just have relations and be personal with people. That's what counts. Otherwise, it's like, well, what is this? It's like we're just in our little office space and we're not breaking out. Like, we need to break out. We need to get in touch with everybody and, you know, and be emotional, be vulnerable, and be transparent about life and doing life. But so today we're in here because turns out that we figured out a little bit about the air conditioning in the multi-purpose room. I don't know what the temperature was today. How hot was it today? Does anybody know? 90 something. So 97. Ooh, we almost broke triple digits. Okay, so 101 somewhere. Oh man, see, so okay, probably because were you driving a black car? What car was it in your car? On your, oh, the silver one. Oh, okay. You know, those black cars track the heat, man. It's tough. But man, 101. So 97, 101. So we're pretty much just we're in the midst of summer. But thank the Lord for this AC right now. I used to drive the Montebello bus for City of Montebello, and you know the AC, it was horrible driving a bus that the AC was not working well, because the air conditioner, instead of, you know, air conditioning, what it stood for. The AC stood for attitude calmer. When people got on the bus, attitudes were calm. If it was not AC, it was unruly and just, it was bad. But we're here, and thank you, Lord, for AC, and thank you for this multi-purpose room, and welcome to this room, you know. So You guys, if you wanted to do any kind of if you felt led to tithe and to give, Robert will be in the back with the tithing offering bag, so we won't have to just pass it around, and you guys could freely give as you feel led. But without further ado, I don't want to talk your guys' ears off. We're gonna get a good message from John. The high schoolers, you guys are okay to move on to the collective room, the high school room, and you'll be getting word from Alex Meza today. She's gonna be sharing my wife. I'm proud of her. All right, guys, well, let's pray, and then we'll just jump right on into it, okay? So Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you so much for today. We thank you for all that you provide for us, God. Lord God, we just put events and the ministry opportunities that are arising, we bring them before you now. I don't want to let them out yet, but it looks like some exciting things to come, Lord God, for First Love Calvary Chapel in City of Whittier. Lord God, you know what it is, Lord God, and we just pray that you would just designate and give authority to the church and open the door, Lord God, for community outreach, Lord God, for evangelism, and just for your gospel and your word to just be, you know, set before the hearts of men and women out here, Lord God, and the young children and everyone above and beyond, Lord God. We love you. We thank you, Lord God. We pray that your Holy Spirit would be in our presence, would be in the midst of us. You would just hover above each and every person here, and that we would we'd be able to receive you completely, fully. And Lord God, we would grow and mature and fulfill righteousness, Lord God, in understanding of your word, Lord God. But we lift up John and his message to you, and Maureen, and just the whole Schaefer family, Lord God. We thank you for, you know, their labor of love and what just this where we're at and what's come out of that, you know, their servitude and faithfulness to you. So, Lord God, we thank you for the servants. We thank you for everyone in ministry. And just wash us cleanse of our sins, Lord God, so we're clean, pure, and holy before you just now. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. All right. God bless you guys.
Their wallets. And so they realize that there's an opportunity out there to get a little bit of extra money if they can find a way to get money from somebody. Oh, man, they gave my kid the wrong medication. Let's sue the hospital. Let's sue the doctors. Let's sue the pharmaceutical companies. Oh, man, that Marky didn't wash out. Let's sue the Sharpie company. I mean, and when we talk about lawsuits, I mean, it's not a joke. I mean, because there are things that are very serious that the only thing that will work is a lawsuit. But then there are things that are frivolous where people are just like, they're sue happy. And they are in the mood to do some litigation and make some money. You know, let's take, for instance, this is right here, a journal. And so, you know, there can be all kinds of, there, turn it real fast, secret things in a journal. I don't know what year that is. You know, I've got all these journals. But anyway, I will tell you that, you know, maybe it's some girl that was keeping her journal in church and some guy that liked her came along and read her journals. And then she says, I'm going to sue you, you know, for everything you own because you, and he didn't just read it, but he posted it online. You know, just people do some wrong things to each other. They hurt one another. They steal from one another. They cheat one another. And with that, there's hurt feelings. And with that, sometimes litigation. But the Bible talks about in the book of 1 Corinthians, and if you want to look in your Bibles, it's actually 1 Corinthians chapter 6, okay? And so you take a look there. And it actually is some guidelines for Christians about what's going on, you know, in the world as far as being wronged or suing and how should you handle things. So I want to read this to you, okay? So let's go for it right now. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, starting in verse 1. It says, dare any of you. Now that means, would any of you be bold enough so as to defy Scripture and defy God on this issue? Now, I have to tell you, there are Christians that just take it that a Christian should never do a lawsuit and just always take a wrong. That's not what this is teaching. So be careful about trying to put that kind of weirdness onto somebody else. But it is definitely teaching that within the church, there need to be some pretty horrific things going on in why you would bring the outside court system into it, rather than dealing with it among believers. So it says, dare any of you to be bold enough to defy Scripture, okay? Having a matter against another. So you've got some business dealing with somebody in the church. They had some sort of service, some sort of a, you know, thing that they were offering you, and then they didn't live up to those expectations. Well, you now have a grievance against them because either, and most likely, they owe you a job and you paid the money ahead of time. You didn't know that they were going to take your money and run. And I've seen things like that. I've seen within the church contractors doing that. And where one time, and some of our attention to these things isn't always in maturity and isn't always in understanding of how bad things can be for people. But I remember there was a sister one time, she was talking about suing this brother that had ripped her off financially, saying he would do a certain amount of work, and she paid him ahead of time, and then she even paid him more, and he didn't do it. And I mean, it was the upwards of $25,000 or something like that. And I thought that this brother and his family were just a great family. And so I'm like, oh no, let's situate this, figure out how they can pay you back and figure this and that out. And so sometimes, you know, as Christians, we all try to make it all work nicely. And that is what the Bible says that we should do first. But, you know, later on I find out that, you know, that particular brother had ripped off his previous church and many people in contractor kind of things, and then other people he had taken within our church. And then I realized that there was just a Judas style handling of money, that that no matter how nice and kind and happy, you know, a person might have seemed on the outside, and how leadership material or anything like that, they were still ripping others off. Had I been maybe a little more mature and had a little more understanding and really not just trusted this brother but researched him a little bit more, I might have not come alongside of the brother that was in the wrong, even though I tried to come alongside of both, but I might have just come alongside of that sister and just went, wow, you're right. You need to just proceed in that way because you've tried all these means and nothing has worked. So the point is situations like that do arise in the church. And that there are brethren who creep in, we'll say unawares, or they seem like brethren, or maybe at some point they were brethren, but you know, their little dollar sign money eyes have the church all figured out of who they can cheat, of who they can defraud, of who they can take advantage of, and in that poor, unbewitting soul, that stupid Christian, that I can just, you know, get what I want out of them. And so having a matter against another, well, in this world, we're going to have matters against others. There are going to be businesses that rip people off, and there are going to be people that rip businesses off. And but it says here in chapter 6, verse 1, it says, but dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous? So the point is talking about that we're going to take it straight to the courts. We're not going to try to figure this out with the pastor, because maybe he doesn't understand the situation. We're not going to try to figure it out with Christian arbitration. We're not going to try to figure it out with somebody that's a lawyer in the church or somebody that's wise and can resolve so that way the church doesn't have to split over it, or Christians don't have to be divided, or at least this person can decide, well, you should go to that church, you should go to this church, and now you need to pay them. But it says that they go to law before the unrighteous and not before the saints. And that's the problem that Paul is pointing out. He's pointing out the witness of the church. That the church can look as bad as the world as far as lawsuits are concerned, and as far as grievances are concerned, and that people are bringing their worldly baggage when they get saved into the church with them. And not that you haven't done that, not that I haven't done that, but it can be to the degree that it is criminal or it is hurtful to another individual. So, you know, we're supposed to leave the baggage at the foot of the cross, right? And we're supposed to let the Lord change our wicked ways and search our hearts and see if we're still operating in this old mode of operation that we once did. But there are people in the church that really are on the prowl and on the lookout for that, you know, soul that just is not so aware. And verse 2, it says, do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And that's kind of an interesting one. That we're going to be right there with the Lord as he's going to be pronouncing his judgment. In fact, the book of Revelation talks about those that persecuted us are going to be bowing at our feet. And it says, and if the world will be judged by you, Are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? So if God has put us, and but not just that final judgment that Jesus does and the Father does in the world, but part of the judge the world there has to do during the 1,000-year reign of Christ, when we rule and reign with Christ, and we're going to be judging all kinds of matters as judges. But he says, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Meaning in the church, God's made some wise Christians. He's made some sensible Christians. I know the scripture says in Corinthians that there's not many wise among you. And so when you do look at the church, you look at definitely some unreasonable people. You definitely look at people that have come fresh out of the world, you know, and that they're still thinking like the world. But you definitely have some mature Christ-like believers there as well. And so it says that you can bring this before the saints. The saints are those that are sanctified by the Lord, those that have been called out from the world, the religious community, God's people, that first, if it's church member against church member, church business against church business, let's try to figure this out in some sort of a holy way that doesn't just make, you know, the church and the Christians look bad. Because sometimes, you know, our dirty laundry can look pretty bad. And so the truth is that we can handle small matters in the church, just like something that's called small claims court. And a lot of those small matters, you know, do you really need that $20? Do you really need that $100 that badly? Is it really that important to see that person pay? Is it really that important to see that person now pay you $10,000 or go to jail? I absolutely believe that there is a time for that. And we've seen situations, and I tend to sometimes operate on the merciful side of things because sometimes I haven't understood so well the worldly side of things. And I've seen people hurt in the church, and yet I've still tried to, you know, play that peacemaker and that advocate and, you know, looking at both sides when really there is only one side to look at. And so then the pastor could seem like he doesn't know what he's talking about because he doesn't catch all the facts. And definitely, I've been in that place. But the Bible says, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Well, sometimes when you become seasoned having gone through these things, we had one guy, we've had a lot of situations at church, by the way, and I forget exactly how much it was, but people that were related to inside and outside of the church, whether it was this person's credit card bill, $5,000, or this person a few thousand for rent, and it went on and on, and I'll pay you back this, and I'll pay you back that. And, I mean, it hit church members, it hit family members, it hit just all kinds of people. And I'm thinking, oh, wow, this is, you know, when it finally really started coming alive that this person, you know, had even taken checks that were supposed to be for guest speakers and put them into his own account. And, you know, and you're looking and going, okay, this is something within a church. This is something brother or, you know, I mean, I know earlier in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, it says if the person doesn't repent, you can count them as a heathen and a tax collector. But sometimes people do horrendous things and they still repent. And so there's, you know, small matters that can be judged by us, but then sometimes there's really big matters. Now, in that particular instance, I did try to bring another pastor into it. I think more than one pastor, outside pastors. And I brought the person to the church and I had these pastors there. And the person said, oh, they realized they felt like it was entrapment for them. You know, I'm not going to talk to them. And so they kind of were huffy about it. And so I couldn't resolve the situation in that way. And then in the next week or two, even more people were hurt. And so even at that point in time, you know, because we were trying to figure out, do we call the law? Do we have a case? You know, all of that. But maybe it should have been another pastor so people weren't looking at their pastor as Mr. Lawyer or the pastor that understands, you know, what needs to be a lawsuit and what doesn't. Because I'm not necessarily the litigation type of guy. I'm not the one that, you know, understands these things to the nth degree. And so I'm bound to mess up and not definitely, you know, going to bring you, you know, good pleasure where you're going to be pleased. Oh, Pastor John handled that so well. So is there not a wise man among you? But what I think for myself personally, now that I've seen so much crud and so much bad, that I realize that, yeah, if this situation came up, here's how I'd handle it next time. And understanding that no matter how smiley, no matter how leadershipy, no matter how nice somebody might appear to be, or even just a fallen Christian, that matters are sometimes legal situations or serious situations that have to have, you know, very serious church discipline, like we read about in 1 Corinthians 5 where it says, put them out of the church. And then so it says in verse 3, do you not know that we will judge angels? So it goes from judging the world, and specifically it's talking about the thousand-year reign of Christ, and then judge angels at the end of the great white throne judgment when they're thrown into the lake of fire, and we're going, is this the one who shook the nations? We're going to be partaking somehow in the judgment of the angels. It's a way into the future matter, but God is saying, if you guys are going to be judges, kings and priests in the world, and judges, and you're going to be even judging angels, I think that you've got the wisdom of Christ. I think that you've got the mind of Christ, and you've got sensibility, and you've got common sense, and you've got scripture, that you could be able to cut through things and find out what is truth and what is error and who needs to pay up and who needs to step aside and all that kind of stuff. And so also what I like about that is it doesn't put it all onto the pastor. It puts it into the place of people that are in the congregation that have to handle that church as well. Now, I understand, you know, we don't want just a vigilante church that everybody's just handling every legal matter because, you know, sometimes we do need to bring things before the spiritual leadership. Hey, do you think this is a matter I should handle? And that's only if it's very serious. Small matter, handle it. And just know what God wants you to do, because it doesn't have to all be the, you know, it's not really a hierarchy in the church, but, you know, the hierarchy, you know, these guys, they're on that place where they know how to judge a matter. But it says, don't you know that you're going to judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? Now, that's 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 3 that we're on. And the things of this life do get to us, and they do get us. They do hit us. They do, like those fiery darts, pierce us. And we are either ripped off of money. I mean, we had one guy that was stealing from the church for a few months, and it took us a while to catch him. And I remember one time I was in my office on a day that there were no cars at the church. My wife dropped me off, and I hear the door open, and this person walks down the dark hallway, creepy hallway at the church, and I'm like, I just, in my boldness, yes, I'm not scared of lions or anything, and I got up, and I'm not going to say his name, but I go, oh, and he goes, oh, Pastor John, you know, I was just going to give you back this key, and blah, 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 and I'm like, okay, I know that you're the one that's been doing this, and so then, you know, we had that long talk. We had another usher that joined our usher ministry just to take from the offerings, and when he got caught, that's what he said. He goes, that's why I joined, and that's why I tried to really become good friends with the head usher, and so I could, you know, kind of work my way in. And his whole point. So if churches go through this, I mean, there was a Judas in Jesus' ministry that took from the offerings, right? But if churches go through this, how much more do all of us in our workplaces or in our schools or among people that we know and that we bump against, do we go through things that are very grievous to us? And it says that things that pertain to this life, we should be able to figure that out to some degree. Verse 4, it says, if then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? And why would the Roman courts back then be least esteemed by the church? Because people knew that there was a lot of corruption that would go on in the courts. People knew that justice wasn't always justice. And so the church, because the church was persecuted, and the church obviously wasn't treated fairly by the Roman government, so therefore the courts were least esteemed by the church, and yet here they judge against us as believers, and yet we're going to go ahead and take our brother to court and go, and here's the fellow Christian at church who did this to me. And you can see where, you know, Paul's going, this looks really messed up and confusing. And so he says, it says in verse 4, if you have judgments concerning things that pertain to this life, do you appoint those that are least esteemed by the church to judge? I say this to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one, who will be able to judge between his brethren? But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. And so Paul was just like, oh my gosh, this is bad. You know, it's like my wife has to always check her oxygen, but her anxiety has been up, so she's not checking her oxygen as much now, because it's, you know, all of a sudden it's low. But you know, these things, the batteries go dead, they drop on the floor, And these pulsometer, oximeter, oxygen read things, you know, say it wasn't giving you the right read and you were having anxiety for nothing. Oh, I'm going to sue that company, you know. And so people have it all figured out like that. Some people, it's because they want to live off of society and they want to live off of somebody else's money. And they feel an entitlement to sue other people to make sure that they can, you know, just kind of go on with life and rest and pay for their gas and their rent on whatever the settlement was. But, you know, people like that. The settlements disappear and then they end up having to sue somebody else. And so, you know, and then those people go to church and they're in the church. And do you think that they're not going to be judged, maybe even as an unbeliever, in the way that they tried to cheat people in this world and the way that they behaved in a worldly manner? So it says, but brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers. So there is a line that's drawn there. Now, sometimes people just say, well, you know, say somebody hits your car, and well, if it's a brother, well, then let them off the hook. Well, but you have insurance for that reason, and you don't really have to know the person personally. And so there's things that are just operated with at a business level, and it's not taken before judges, and it's not, you know, a situation of the church. But then there's situations we allow into our lives. Well, the person borrowed my car. Well, the person, I loaned them money. And we have those kind of situations, and then you've been hurt by it. And how do I handle it? And even the loaning has to be with the intent of not receiving it back. That we have to have within our hearts the idea that, will you not accept the wrong? And I think that sometimes Christians are not willing to accept the wrong. That they're, you know, it's like, hey, you stepped on my toes. You stepped on my wallet. You've taken my money and you're hurting me. And I believe that we've got to really be careful of some of the worldliness that's still in our hearts, and that we understand that, you know, Jesus was wounded for others. And there are times where we're going to be wounded and still have to show love and not act like the world. Verse 7, it says, now therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? Now, okay, you think that that's on the person who got hurt, right? Well, you know, they cheated you, but why not just let yourself be cheated? But check this out. It says in verse 8 of 1 Corinthians chapter 6, it says, no, you yourselves do wrong, and you cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Like the reason why you won't accept a wrong is because you're not going to accept anybody doing that against you, because you yourself do it. You're doing wrong, and you're cheating, and you're doing things like that to your brethren. So there was some real problems going on in that Corinthian church, for sure. But I have to say that a couple thousand years later, there's some real problems going on in our Christian churches today as well. And then in verse 9 it says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Now that phrase, the unrighteous, it's putting that after it's talking about Christians, after it's talking about brother against brother. And it's saying that sometimes those who do wrong and those who cheat their brethren are really unbelievers. They really are those that would be put out of the church and put out of the, you know, eternal city that God has. And so do you not know that those, here it says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. So, pastor, don't be deceived when it's Christian against Christian, that one of those Christians might really be wrong. Don't be deceived, believer, that even though they seemed all nice and everything like that, they did really rip you off. And then it goes on and throws in other sins besides cheating and besides what was just doing wrong to somebody, and in this case suing somebody, and maybe even for the wrong reasons. So it says neither fornicators, so those who are taking advantage of somebody sexually in the church, or idolaters, and it doesn't necessarily have to be in the church, but or idolaters, those who put other things before God in their lives and worship that even though they go to church, nor adulterers, those who commit adultery against their marriage, nor homosexuals, those who commit homosexuality, it says, nor sodomites, part of homosexuality. It says, nor thieves, having to do with cheating, having to do with stealing. It says, nor covetous, wanting things that aren't yours, longing for it, nor drunkards, nor revilers, you know, party people. It says, nor thieves, nor covetous. Oops, I kind of went over that again. It says, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. So it kind of gives this list that, guys, church, guess what? You might end up falling into the unrighteous category. You might be going to church, and you might think, I'm going to heaven, you know, because I've got my doctrine right. I know that, you know, nothing can make you unsaved. And it says, but you know what? You're living unrighteously. Don't think that you're going to inherit the kingdom of God. It doesn't say here, it's not talking about a Christian who's doing the 1 John 1:9, oh Lord, you know, forgive me. It's not talking about the believer that's doing the James 5, 6 or 9 thing where it says, confess your faults to one another, pray for one another, you'll be healed. It's not talking about somebody who's trying to walk with God. It's talking about somebody who's doing wrong to their sister and brother and trying to get away with it. And it says, in verse 11, it says, and such were some of you. Like some of you went to church and were those kinds of people. And you've been called out before, and you, the Holy Spirit has had your number, and you've had to repent of that. Now, I, at times in my life, have really loved this scripture, and such were some of you. Because when you find yourself struggling or stumbling or doing things wrong in your walk, and then you see a list of sins there in the Bible, and you realize that Paul was pointing out to the church that they had all done things wrong, then it kind of puts you on this even playing field with everybody needing God. And it's like, thank you, Lord, that such were some as you. But then the encouraging next part of verse 11 in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 is that, but you were washed. And so for all of your trying to get something because you want to sue somebody, and all of you are trying to cheat somebody because you want to get something, all of you are covetous and trying to get something, all of your thievery and trying to get something, all of you are ripping somebody off sexually because you're trying to get something, all of that, it says, they don't inherit the kingdom, but such were some of you, but you were washed. What could be better than Jesus washing all of you from the inside out? You were sanctified. You were now called a saint of God, set apart by the Lord. But you were justified. You were declared innocent, even though you were truly guilty. It says, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Like, I mean, it was a total work of Jesus and the Holy Spirit in your life. So, brethren, you know, Jesus said offenses will come. There are going to be matters and charges that we have against one another, sometimes very legitimate. You know, one time there was a situation where my wife and I bought a house in 2005. And then, as you remember, 2008, there was that economy crash and the housing industry and everything. And we ended up upside down on our house. But the house that we bought the person from, he was the lender through a lending company that his name was on. He was the realtor. He was the homeowner, home flipper. And so he was just kind of all of these things. And we didn't see until about a year later, and plus we didn't even get the stuff right away, that he had actually lied on some of the paperwork. And so the house was bought fraudulently. And technically, we could have owned his house and everything that he owned. But at that time, it was just so hard as far as everybody was losing their houses and everything was going crazy. And to try to fix the situation at that time was craziness. I probably could have gotten a lot of money if we had known how to properly file at Bank of America for, you know, this fraudulent loan that we had. But I didn't know how to do that. I saw people got all kinds of money. We didn't. You know, and some people are good at paperwork and some people just aren't, right? And but we were in this situation, and here this guy was. He sold his house. Oh, well, a pastor needs a house. And we were in a situation where we had to move quickly and we needed to be in a house. And I want to sell my house to you, you know, used car salesman. And he was a interpreter of the Chinese language at a huge event within our grouping of churches. And so I'm thinking, this guy, he's an translator for the Chinese language. He's, you know, Christian, cares about his brother being saved. I mean, just, you know, everything. And he wants to help us. And all the while, you know, one of my administrators would say, make sure you get it on paper, get it on paper, you know. And a lot of things were awry. But so we were bamboozled. No doubt. And not because we were stupid. I mean, I knew before we even bought the house that people, you know, there was going to be a bubble that was going to pop and people are going to lose their houses. I said that like weeks before this even happened, months before it even happened. But then I ended up in a situation where I had to get a house. You know, bad timing. And yet we brought brethren together, board members from a couple of different churches, bring the guy over, looked at his past false financial dealings, brought it before him, and like this deer in headlights, but wouldn't own up, and it really didn't go anywhere. And you know, sometimes these situations, guys, are hard, and they affect our lives. I've got lots of stories to tell, and my life's been very affected, just as yours has, by people who've offended you and grieved you and have taken from you. And you know, and some of it is, you know, your down payment, your hard-earned money. So there's real issues out there, and those issues are also in the church. And those issues do have to be dealt with, sometimes first within the church and then secondarily in the courts, but they do need to be dealt with because they're a legal situation. But the way that we deal with things is not as the world does at first. The first thing that we do is we get down on our knees. I mean, we just like, Lord, I give this to you. Lord, please help me. Lord, you know, show me. Lord, give me wisdom. Lord, show me who to bring into this situation. And because just going to court doesn't mean that it's going to go in your favor. It doesn't mean you're going to get a bunch of money. It doesn't mean, you know, it doesn't mean any of that. It means that you spent all this money on a lawyer and you better, you know, have the more money and the better lawyer, because if they are richer and have a better lawyer, they're going to get away, you know, with things because of the way that they can put together their little defense. And so we do have guidelines as Christians. It doesn't mean that lawsuits are never allowed, but it does mean you definitely got to think it through. There definitely needs to be some church interaction in it. But, you know, sometimes, you know, when you've read Christian articles and you read about, okay, they were filming these end time movies and then this particular company was the one that was doing their promotional and putting out their movies to the theaters, and they didn't live up to their expectations, and so now they're suing them. And this really has happened in the Christian community. And a lot of Christians are just like, how could they do that? The Bible says not to sue. Well, yes and no, because the Bible doesn't say not to sue. It says to try to solve it before some wise believers. But if you can't, and you have to treat the person like an unbeliever, there is a next step. But it's a hard thing, and it's an ugly thing when the world sees it, and they see this person who created this script, and then they see this Christian movie company, and they're in this big lawsuit. So believe me, it happens. I mean, even from our group, you know, there's been some of the larger churches that have lost millions in lawsuits and things that you don't just hear about. Not that I understand all the details of it, but I know that there's serious situations that happen with you, with others, with churches, with businesses. I'll just give you a little bit more here. You know, there was one time somebody was in our church, and of course it was my kid's fault. My kid had a pickle drop out of their McDonald's hamburger. You know, one of those flat pickles? And this person slipped on it. They didn't get hurt, but still, you know, I mean, you care for people. They slipped on it, pickle, in the lobby, on the lobby floor, and they wrote a letter, this whole thing. They're going to bring a lawsuit to the church because of slipping on this McDonald's pickle. And so we had to have a Christian lawyer write a letter back, and it worked for a few different reasons without explaining everything to you guys in this message. But then there was another situation where somebody wanted to bring some litigation because they felt like their relative, who had some certain needs, was misunderstood and mishandled by somebody in the church, and so then they bring these things saying, we're going to do this to the church, and you know what that does to a pastor? Wait. I mean, I've got my wife sitting over here that is like, that's some weight because she's going through suffering. I've got just the church to run. That's weight. I've got leadership things and decisions to deal with. That's weight. But to have somebody try to bring litigation, whoo, that's weight. And so how can we even hold up under all that weight, right? And thank God for being saved. Thank God for having Jesus. Thank God that God has scriptures. And so there's just some bad stuff. But the first thing and foremost is try to win a brother, right? Try to win somebody. Try to not be a shame to the world before the unbelievers. That there are worldly things that happen to us, even in the church. And there is a time to deal with it at that level. But just like the Bible talks about divorce, Christians don't just go and get a divorce. They have to really think it through and understand what the scriptures say and understand why they're doing what they're doing and even ask themselves, do I realize I might never get married again? Depending on if it was, you know, a biblically grounded divorce or not. And or you know, a Christian talking about pay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and taxes. And yet maybe they're lying and cheating and holding back. Or when it comes to lawsuits, yes, there are Christian laws or Christian guidelines or Christian rules that we're supposed to be living by. And so if you have a business, you have to be happen to be a businessman or woman, there's a way to handle it. I mean, who knows, even with this, you know, coronavirus situation, people are going to be like suing over their mask. The mask made me get asthma. You know, I mean, who knows what kind of lawsuits we're going to hear in the future over all of this. And so basically, in other words, that Christians are supposed to take a step back and not just handle things the same way that the world handles it. I know, like, our particular president, who's done really well for Israel and really well for Christians and for the unborn and such, but, you know, as a businessman, he's hardcore. And he's been through a gazillions of lawsuits and against him or him suing and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And so his life has been a life of lawsuits. But the ordinary believer, that shouldn't be the case. You know, going, well, look at, they handle it this way or they do it. That, you know, no. That isn't the way that God wants us to reflect our walk, and that he wants us to be able to, you know, deal with things in a wise way. So that's where that phrase being sue happy comes in. You know, that people are just contentious and people are just in a mood for litigation and money. And so our society is prone to engaging in lawsuit after lawsuit for who knows whatever reason, and that creeps into the church. And people are hurt from it. And that's one reason why I'm kind of glad that we stayed a small church, because I don't have to go through as much junk as some of these bigger churches have gone through. You know, you ever hear that lawsuit about McDonald's and how the coffee through the drive-thru spilled on the person and they made a lawsuit and everybody says it was a frivolous lawsuit, and they, you know, joke about it, about, you know, coffee spilling on you from McDonald's and making all this money. And it's a well-known, one of the most well-known suits in the nation. And so, you know, I've heard tons of people joke about it over the years. But if you really do read the lawsuit, at that time, McDonald's wasn't wise and they used scalding hot water. And the lady actually got her whole inner thighs burnt, you know, like as if hot water was poured on you and it made all your skin bubble, not to scare anybody. But so she was forever scarred from it. So it was a serious, serious situation. And it changed the way that they delivered coffee to people and the degrees they gave it when a person would receive it. So that way, obviously, that lawsuit would never happen again. And so sometimes a lawsuit or justice being done in a situation can bring about change in a society, or safety in a society, or you know, people getting along with each other better in a society. But it's frivolous when people are just looking for opportunities to make money. Sometimes some of those believers who are sue happy are not true believers, and sometimes people knowingly make false claims and stand by them in order to get what they want. They do that to collect money on a house. They burn their car to collect money on a car. There's just, you know, some devilish and deceitful things going on in the heart of man, and that happens within the church as well. And yet, if you are under one of those things, if somebody is oppressing you with that right now, and they're coming against you and trying to take your house and trying to, you know, really bring a suit against you, just know, apart from wisdom, that as Paul said, no one stood with me at my first defense, but the Lord stood with me. Let me tell you that God stands with you. And so God can make that claim come to nothing. God can turn the tables on them. And people, you know, can make up things and sue for just about anything as Christians, and that is not honoring to God. It's tearing down the church. It's taking from their brother. And the judge is standing at the door who shows no partiality in judgment. And just like Ananias and Sapphira, you could drop like a dead man. And but yet, it is our joy as men and women and young people to honor God in all of our worldly dealings, because such were some of you. But you are washed, you are cleansed, you are sanctified. So what are those worldly dealings? And how might you step back and make sure that you're handling it in Christ first? And trying to, you know, really, instead of like, you wronged me, and therefore I'm having you put away forever or whatever. We do have to care about our witness before unbelievers. We've got to sometimes fix a broken witness when we've just, you know, been the boy that cried wolf. And so sometimes there's work and home, schools, and neighbors that we've got to try to, you know, make sure that we're shining and fix a place where maybe we didn't shine because they heard something just threatening come out of our mouth. We've got to adorn, like the temple in Israel was adorned and beautiful. We've got to adorn this temple of God, this heart and mind before the world. And some people think, well, I don't care what the world thinks. Well, then you're probably not a believer, because a believer does care what the world thinks. They care about how their words and their actions affect the world and therefore affect their witness for Christ. So if you don't care, you're probably not one of us, is what it comes down to, or you're just very deceived. In 1 Timothy 3:7, it says, moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside. Do you have a good testimony among those who are outside the church? 1 Thessalonians 4:12, it says that you may walk properly toward those who are outside. Are you trying to have your dealings and your worldly dealings with people inside and outside of the church look good to those who are outside? And then in Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, it says, walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. Oh Lord, even if I don't have wisdom of my own, put somebody around me that has some wisdom so I can look good for those who are outside. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 13, it says, but those who are outside, God judges. And understanding that, you know, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, and there is a final judgment, even if you don't win in the courts. And then in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 3 to 6, it tells ladies not to let your outer adorning be that of, you know, putting on the fine apparel and the gold and everything, but rather the hidden person of the heart and the incorruptible beauty of a quiet and gentle spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. It says, for in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husbands. And so there is a way that we can adorn ourselves, a way that we can look to the world in the way that we come off. And so let's do our best to come off as best as we can come off, as far as recognizing that we do have a witness for Christ. And if you blow it, then tell somebody you blew it. But just a reminder that you know that maybe one time in your life you were there. You were wrong. But the Lord had a lot of grace for you. All of those such were some of you. Those such were. Were you a such were? And, you know, you're not walking in the continuance of the world without repentance, but you're a such were because you did turn to Christ in repentance. And time again, many times, you've been blessed by that grace of Christ in your life to get you past junk and baggage that you've carried with you. And one of the proofs that you're a true church member and a true member of the family of God is that you have problems, but that you don't just hide the problems and cover over the problems, but you deal with the problems and you admit to the problems and you try to fix the problems, kind of like Zacchaeus. I'm going to pay everybody back everything that I ripped them off of. So don't give up on your brethren. But understand that if you are taking advantage, God is the avenger of such, and God can act speedily. And reminding those that do such things, if that's a lifestyle, you're not going to inherit the kingdom. And, you know, it's different than stumbling, as I said. It has to do with, you know, a heart, and God can see whether it's really a true heart or a false heart. So God wants their unrighteous seen to be not in control in the church. He wants it to be the righteous acting righteously by seeking out a wise saint, and or rather accepting a wrong. We've got to just be open to the Lord working in these ugly lawsuit type of situations, because the Lord is looking out for his children. He's looking out for you. You are the sheep of his pasture. And so you are one of his children, and that person is hurting one of his children. And so, you know, God can get you through this, and God can get you to the other side. No doubt about it. And so sometime in your walk, if this all seems so foreign to you, sometime in your walk, you might face something like this. There are people in our church, even now, that have faced things like this, that each have their own story and would explain this Bible study a little bit differently than I do, depending on how they were wronged. But God has supernatural wisdom in our churches if we're able to look for it. Somebody that can search out a matter and weigh things in a balance and figure out where the need is and where the one wanting is. One particular sister, you know, if you would leave your purse open in the church, she would definitely take money off of the top of it. And but there's a lot of people with problems, whether it be, who knows, you know, what problem it came from, whether it was by birth or by car accident or by medical condition or whatever. But in those situations, sometimes people in the church end up funding them. They ask for money, and people in the church that are nice, they give them money. And really, the families might not want them to have money, and then they're funding somebody's marijuana habit or whatever. And it's like, we just have to be so careful to be nice and do good, but be careful to know the story, so that way you're really helping the right person. And that you're not accommodating somebody who's just ripping you off. I guess a few last points that I would like to make as I get through this Bible study. I'm going to just kind of skim through my notes here. It says in Revelation 3, "Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews and are not, but lie," talking about those that are of the church of Satan there, not literally, but spiritually. It says, "Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you." So one day, at that judgment of the world and the judgment of the angels, those people are going to bow at your feet and know that Jesus loved you. And then also in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, I already read it to you, but why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? But instead you cheat and you do wrong. And so God means for a Christian to look and see, I'm pointing my finger at what they did to me, but am I doing that to anybody else? Should I be accepting a wrong in this situation, or should I be pushing it through because the person is going to hurt other people? Now, sometimes people, you know, when they say wrong things and they do wrong things, they'll even say, "Well, why don't you sue me?" And so they come off sarcastically when you are opposed to their actions and their opinions. But one of these days, that person might actually get sued. And so sometimes Christians can come off kind of stinky to one another and even to the world, and when they're naming the name of Christ, you're going to just have situations that you're going to be cheated in, and don't look for that to now be your financial windfall. And don't watch too much of, and I don't mean it's a bad program, but I mean, don't watch too much of Judge Judy or whatever, and where you're thinking, "Oh, wow, this is a made-for-TV thing. Let me take this one to the courts." Romans 2:21, therefore, it says, "Who teach another, do you not teach yourself? You who preach that a man shouldn't steal, do you steal? You who say don't commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? You who make your boast in the law, do you dishonor God through breaking the law? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you." It says the name of God is looked at in a very cruddy way because of you. Lord, please help us. Help us as a church to properly represent you. Help us not to be, and if I can find that, I don't know if I dropped it or not, but I had that little mask that was, and I think, yeah, I definitely lost it, but, oh, it's over here. And, you know, it was like, this is it. Let's see, was that? Okay, Sue Happy on that side, that's backwards. But then this way, you know, there we go, Sue Happy. You know, that we got to make sure that we know 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and that we are not so happy. But happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we just come before you. We pray, Lord God, that we would know how to properly deal with deceitful and cheating matters within the church. We pray, Lord, as I've had to learn my lessons, we pray that I would be able to deal fairly among people in the church. We pray that other churches who have lawsuits or people coming against the ministry or people come against one another or business, Christian business against Christian business, have your hand upon that, Lord. Have your hand upon those that are listening to the study and feel broken over these things. And so whether the person's broken because they've been hurting others, or they feel broken because somebody is right now trying to hurt them, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would vindicate them. Pray in the name of Jesus you would lift this weight from their shoulders. And so, Lord God, help our brethren. Help us all, Lord, to glorify Christ in this matter. Mm-hmm. Forgive us of our sins in this matter, for such were some of us. But, Lord, you've sanctified and you've washed, and we thank you for that. And lastly, if you're going to rededicate your life, say, Lord, I rededicate my life to you. I come back to you today. I return to Jesus today. Say that. I give my life to you again, Lord. I'm going to start going back to church. I'm going to start serving you, God. Help me to stay on the straight and narrow in Jesus' name. And coming to Christ for the first time, Jesus, make me born again. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. I repent. I turn from every sin that I've done, and I lay them at the foot of the cross. I give it all to you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, God bless you and have a great rest of the week. All right. Sins in this matter, for such were some of us. But Lord, you've sanctified and you've washed, and we thank you for that. And lastly, if you're going to rededicate your life, say, Lord, I rededicate my life to you. I come back to you today. I return to Jesus today. Say that. I give my life to you again, Lord. I'm going to start going back to church. I'm going to start serving you, God. Help me to stay on the straight and narrow in Jesus' name. And coming to Christ for the first time, Jesus, make me born again. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. I repent. I turn from every sin that I've done, and I lay them at the foot of the cross. I give it all to you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, guys, God bless you and have a great rest of the week. All right.
Awesome. I don't know about you guys, but my heart really broke after, like, hearing this message. Like, wow, like, we could be a church, and we just need to, like, we need the Lord in the church, obviously, but, like, the gospel is for everybody, and we should never be ashamed to keep saying, Lord, I need you, and I need you, and I need you. Like, the Bible says that we should beg him and have this holy fear that we are shaking that when we present our faith. And so I just wanted to ask if you guys could kneel, if you're able, to kneel on the floor in this last time of worship, and really pray on behalf of our church, on behalf of yourself, on behalf of your family, just seeking the Lord that he would be the center of everything that you have. So yeah, if you guys are able, you can kneel. If you're not, I invite you to sit with us. Jesus, be the center of it all. Jesus, be the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, you're the center, and everything revolves around you. Jesus, you. Jesus, be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end.
church. This is your church, God. Jesus, be the center of your church. And every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess you, Jesus. 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 Nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Jesus, your center, and everything revolves around you. Jesus, you be the center of it all.
Lord, thank you so much for this time to be fed by your word, Lord. And in worship, that we could just worship you, God. And I thank you for the day that we will be before you in the throne, and we could kneel, and we could sing, and we could cry, and we could just embrace who you are, God. And we pray on behalf of our church at First Love Calvary Chapel in Whittier, Lord. Pray for everyone in here, God, that every life, every heart, every decision, God, would be centered and focused on you, because that's all that matters in this world. You're all that matters, God. Remove the idols in our hearts. Remove filthy language from our mouth, God, that we would be holy, living sacrifices for you. So we love you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for kneeling, guys.